Hello everyone, my name is ThePrimeagen. I am an engineer at Netflix. I have 4 kids and a very beautiful wife. I created this course in TypeScript, Go, and Rust because I get the question all the time. How do I create my next project? What do I create? Well, this will give you the opportunity to see the same project in 3 different languages. In this course, we go over the basics of each language along with solving some example problems. In the end, we build a fully unit-tested CLI application in TypeScript, Go, and Rust. I hope you enjoy this course. All right. So I'm gonna just copy that whole get value. Let's do the exact same thing right here. Let's do get value, but this time we're gonna have to do it a little bit different. Let's go get value. And I wanna test out foo, which should just return to me bar 3, right? Awesome, so it should do that, which means I should be, I'm gonna change this to a let, which means that, that I should be able to reassign this at a different path and see bar 2, correct? I should also be able to get fem and get this from our root directory, right? Like I should be able to kind of move ourselves around and do this and get all the correct stuff, correct? Everyone's kind of on board with that. That shows really the power that we're doing all the operations we want. I feel like this is a fairly good test for this. All right, so let's set a value. Let's prove that we can set a value without overwriting anything. So I'm gonna actually upgrade this little testing method to include data, and it's just gonna equal get data. So that way I can provide the same data twice and see that I'm not mutating it in any sort of way. That should not happen, right? So let's just do data right here. Fantastic. We are now passing in a data, and all of our previous ones won't break due to the beauty of default arguments. All right, so let's set a value. We're gonna grab out a projector at foo bar. Let's go projector.setValue, and we're gonna, let's first override a value. Let's do, foo baz. Oh yeah. Hopefully everyone still is always okay with foo, bar, and baz. I like those values. I just find that they're pleasant to use. All right, so when I get this, I should expect to see baz, correct? I think that's the value we should expect. Fantastic. So let's just run this one more time, see how we're doing. Oh my goodness, it just keeps on being a first try. It's the greatest moment of my life. It's better than my wedding day to be able to do this first try. So let's see if this happens. Hopefully my wife will never listen to this. All right, so let's do that. Everything's great. And now what I should be able to do is also set one more value, right? I should be able to set fem, is better than great. Right? And that should overwrite it at this location of foo bar, but shouldn't overwrite it at the root directory. And so we're going to kind of test that out. So I'm gonna add one more, data equals get data, so I can hold on to this, pass in that data, set this value, awesome. I should be able to get that value and have it come right out, right? Is better than great, right? Prove that even though we have a value deeper in the tree or higher up in the tree, shallower in the tree. I'm not sure which direction, depending on how you view what is upstream and downstream. Should exist, awesome. So I'm just gonna recreate projector. Projector equals get projector. And we're just gonna use slash, pass in data, and I should be able to expect this value is great. Correct, we did not overwrite anything. We've properly kept the structure of this projector. Do this one last time. All right, let's do remove value. Awesome, so this should do the exact same thing. We should only remove from our directory and not directories below us. And this one can be done pretty straightforward. It should be pretty easy to be able to do. So I'm just gonna go const projector. And the first thing I'm gonna do is go projector delete value. Oh no, it's a remove. It's remove value, did I call it remove value? Oh, I thought I called it delete value. Anyways, doesn't really matter. Let's remove fem. Now remember, fem's at the root directory, we're at foo bar. This should now, this should effectively produce nothing. I should be able to get the value and it should still be is great, correct? Because we shouldn't be removing anything at our level. But we should be able to remove foo and grab foo, which will now become bar 2, because we have removed bar 3 from our level, it should fall back. And I believe this will pretty much test most conditions that can happen inside of our projector program, and we've kept the state consistent because there is almost nothing worse than if you have a bunch of configuration and state gets messed up. It can be an emotionally challenging time. So I feel like it's very good to have some pretty strong tests around this. Let's run the test. My goodness, my gracious. So I'm just gonna go over the code really kind of quickly here because I feel like Go, since there's less familiarity here, we should probably kind of go over that. So in this world, we can do things like this. And let me just dab that. I can create a function that's like, you know, returns error. And this thing is gonna return a type error. So I can return a new format and go RF, this is an error with value, and I'll make this thing say take in a int. And we'll do that, and I'll take in the value. And look at that, we have this beautiful little error that's returned from this function. Now Go treats all errors like values. Right, there are panics. Panics, you don't want a panic to happen because panics just destroy the program, right? It's where you cannot handle the error at all. It would be equivalent to the case of an error being thrown in some async callback in which nobody handles, right, in JavaScript. If no one can, it just terminates the programs, and that's terrible. There is apparently some way to avoid some level of termination, but we're never going to be getting into that today. So if I were to do this, I could do something like this. Err equals returns error. And I can give it a value, say 5. Now I have this error. I actually have the error. So this means that if we were to have something that looks like this, struct foo, right? So some class, right? Some struct out there that has some basic variables. Oh, sorry, type struct. Can't get those backwards. So in Go, that's how you specify struct. But I had some sort of struct that had some values, and it had a function on that struct. So in TypeScript, you put it on the class. In Rust, you do that impl call. In Go, it's even a little bit more kind of goofy. You can say something like this, Go function, and then you can add it on there, and then you go, this is on foo, right? And this can return also an error, and do the exact same thing. Here, let me just grab that, 6 down, and paste that up there. And so I could do the exact same thing, error equals, foo equals foo. And then go foo, and as you can see, there's an error right there, and I could actually get the error out, and this thing would be an error, right? More so, when you're creating structs and there is a potential for error, let's kind of go over that, because I feel like this is very, very important to understand. How about this one? Create foo. Oh, by the way, if it starts with a capital letter, it's exported in Go. I think it's one of the tragically best and worst concepts ever, because it feels nice, but at the same time, oh man, there's something that just kills me on the inside when I don't want to export a type. I have to have a lowercase, and it just, I'm emotionally bruised by that, right? Some people get emotionally bruised about other things. I get it with capital letters, right? It just really hurts me. So let's say we're just going to create a foo, and there's a chance that this thing could error. So how do we return this? Well, if we did this, foo, error, let's go over what would happen. Let's say that if, we'll add a little number in here, bool fail, right? Oop, the other way around, fail bool. There we go. So if we were to fail, we should return the error. So that means we have to return a foo object and then the error, right? So then I could just go up here and I could just grab this thing really quickly. There we go, right? How beautiful is that? Whoopsies. Hey. What are you? Where are you? RF? We just can use RF, whatever. There we go. This is good enough. But there you go. So that returns an error. But what's the problem? We have to create this thing every single time. So what you'll often see in the Go world is anything that throws an error always comes as a pointer, right? And what this means is I have the magical ability to call it nil, but I have to turn it into a pointer on this side. And so this is pretty much error handling in Go. You see it all the time because you don't want to have to create the object every single time there's an error, right? You just want to return the error, and that is it. There's also an errors package that I could use and just go errors.new if I didn't want to do this. But either way, it's the same kind of concept, is that we have this ability to return either an error or the value. And Go always makes you handle this. And I think this is actually a pretty good construct. So I'd do something that looks like this, right? Create foo false, right? And then I'd do something that looks like this. Oh, don't use semicolons. Is that I have this actually built on a hotkey for me. So if I just go like that, it just makes one happen because I just use this that often. You'll see this so often that I actually just have this hotkeyed out. Is it annoying? Yeah, it's annoying because you every like three lines you have this if error does not equal null, handle the error case. But the nice part is that you constantly have to think about errors ahead of time. There's no like, oh, this method throws an error, I should handle this. It's like, no, you have to do it. Like there is no getting out of it. And I do think that this it's a nicer construct to have value as errors. Okay, so remember, everything, always think iterators. What is the thing we always call on this block of text? That's the first thing. What's the first thing we do? Lines. We got to get each line, right? Everyone's like, come on, I knew this, right? Okay, so now we're into iterator zone, which is obviously much nicer. So here's where we're going to get something kind of interesting. So iterators do not give you your index, unlike the one in JavaScript where I just simply need to add the second parameter, which is actually your index into the array. And even the third one is the array itself. I think there's some fun problem with parseInt and using it over a map because it actually passes in a bunch of things. You'll get a bunch of crazy answers. But anyways, let's go here. So there's another thing called enumerate, which will take an iterator and then attach an index to it. And so now I can have the same thing that I had with for each, where I have the I, or the for range in Golang. I can now just have it right here. Again, it's not creating copies of an entire array. It's just adding one value, turning it into a tuple, and adding an index to it. So it's quite nice. So there we go. So enumerate. Very fantastic. This thing, oh man. Again, having a great library to manipulate strings or work with iterators makes using a language really simple. I think that this actually really helps. So now that we have the string line plus its index, we can just do that simple, multiply by three, yada, yada, yada. So let's go like this. Let's filter. Let's use a filter this time because filters feel more exciting. And what is coming into here? So we can destructure. Remember, Rust allows destructuring inside the argument. So we have I believe it should be a reference to a tuple of index and, of course, line. I want to say I'm pretty correct on this one. Let's find out. It looks like I am correct on this one. Okay, awesome. So now that we have this, we need to do something with it. So let's go like this. Let's go line. I'm going to return because remember, I do not use implicit returns. Chars, so that goes over every single UTF-8 character. This is actually going to properly treat the string so you won't have these weird byte problems going on. And then we need the nth item, right? I want the nth item in this array. This is kind of, or in this iterator. It's kind of a cool trick, right? So now I can say, okay, the nth one, of course, is going to be the index multiplied by 3, moduloed by line.length, just like we did before. But what does nth return? So let's take a look at it. We can just jump to its definition. It is an option because it may not exist. So now we kind of have a small problem. It's not a big problem, but we definitely have a smaller problem here. So what can we do here? Well, we can return, we could technically do like is sum. I mean, that would work. We could turn this into a nice if statement, right? So I could go let char at equals this and then convert it into snake case because that'd be rude. And then go if let sum char at equals char at and go if, I know this is a lot of stuff right here, right? If char at equals that, well then what happens, right? We should be able to do this, but then, you know, let's see, we should be able to go return true or return false. Like, right, yeah, I guess you could do that, and it's saying, hey, this is incorrect because you forgot that, and then it's saying this little nice thing, this character is actually not even a string, what are you doing? Okay, you're right, so let's make sure we use a character, not a string. And there you go, this actually technically works. We will be getting that character, but honestly, this doesn't necessarily feel that great. Can we all agree this does not feel that great? Okay, good. I am happy you guys feel the same way. So let's do a flat map instead. Remember, flat maps, if your thing maps, what can you do to it? You can squish it in and just make it work. It feels so great. And remember, if the thing is none, well, guess what? That's okay. It will just ignore it, right? So if we're off, you know, the beaten path, it's perfectly fine. So let's return this thing right here, and let's get rid of this for now. So now we have this beautiful thing that is screwed up because I was using a filter. There we go. So now we have this. So now the next time we call map, it will have the value from the option because it mapped it in, which we can also do a filter now. If we do a filter now, what do you think the thing is inside this closure? What type? Can anyone take a wild guess?
It's a reference to the string or something.
Man, good job. It's a reference to the character, right, that we've just pulled out. It's a reference to the nth character, because remember, filters are references. So if I just put an X right here, go this, it's a reference to the character. Great job. That was really good. You weren't writing any code, so you know, you're like killing it. Just right here. All right, so awesome. So we actually have this. So this is good. So I can do something like this. Filter where X equals the octothorpe, right? And there we go. So we still have one problem. Of course, we have this thing. So we'll just pattern match away the ampersand sign. It's like, hey, this thing is unused still, right? We haven't made it. We haven't changed it from an iterator into something that can actually use the iterator, right? So let's go like this. Count. Tell me that's not pretty great, right? We just simply need to count the atoms. We don't need any of the memory, right? We don't need the know. We just need to know that, hey, were these nth characters, were they pound signs? How many nth characters were pound signs? And so this is like a really kind of clever way to get around this. And so let's do a little println and do one of these. Go all the way down here and do that. And for fun, let's cargo run this bad boy, P3. We hit a 7. So that's exactly what we were looking for. My goodness, it worked first try. Feels good.